Penguin Random House Audio presents I've Seen the End of You, a neurosurgeon's look at faith, doubt, and the things we think we know. This is the author, W. Lee Warren, M.D. Dedicated to Elmer, the first friend to become my patient. Mike, the first patient to become my friend. Mitch, for teaching me how to grieve and still laugh. Philip, for encouraging me to write this. Patty, for a life well lived. Lisa, for showing me the way forward, no matter how dark the path sometimes is. Author's note. The stories in this book are true. I've changed the names and some details of all the patients and most of the physicians I discuss. In addition, some of the patients are composites of several real people in order to illustrate aspects of their care without risk of identifying them. Conversations are reproduced from my memory, and the dialogue is true to the spirit of the conversations, even if the actual words I use have been changed. Pastor John is an amalgam of numerous hospital chaplains, and Doctors Stinson, Grossman, Grimes, and Jackson are wholly fictitious representatives of colleagues. Prologue. Life gets messy. After all they had endured, they remembered that God, the Most High, was their rock, their Redeemer. Psalm 78:35. The Voice Translation. The most difficult and dangerous surgery I've ever performed, I wasn't trained for. I had to do something no surgeon would ever do in the operating room. I had to learn on the job. In the story that follows, you will learn that the title of this book refers to a kind of brain tumor, glioblastoma multiforme, that is almost 100% fatal. My experience with this tumor made me ask questions about how I could honestly pray for my patients or give them news with any credibility or integrity when I already knew they would die. This moral dilemma put me in touch with my spiritual mentor, Philip Yancey, who encouraged me to write about it. I did, but I wrote a different book. I thought, when I wrote my story of being a combat surgeon at Balad Air Base in Iraq, operating on soldiers, civilians, and terrorists alike while coming to terms with the end of one life and the beginning of another, that was my story. But often, the things we think we know are just that, things we only think we know. I've been a person of faith for all my life, but I learned early on, in the trenches of a crumbling first marriage and the bunkers of the Iraq War, that dogmatic belief is not life-sustaining. Only grace is worth believing in. Then, with my patients and in my own story, I thought I saw grace disappear under the onslaught of brutal reality, a reality that could never be changed and that time would never heal. I used to look at my patients' brain scans, see the glioblastoma I knew would ravage their minds and destroy their lives in the coming months, and say to myself, "I've seen the end of you." But in the aftermath of war, divorce, rebuilding, and then unimaginable loss in my personal life, I realized I was standing at the deathbed of my shattered faith. I'd seen the end of me too. So I faced the greatest surgical challenge of my life, stitching together fatal cancers, dying children, and Christian cliches to heal the faith I'd lost and hoped to resurrect in some unforeseen new form. What happens when our messy lives mess with what we think we believe? Part 1. Before. Hope, in its stronger forms, is a great deal more powerful stimulant to life than any sort of realized joy can ever be. Friedrich Nietzsche, The Antichrist. 1. Riptide. If you have questions, ask away. Just be prepared when God answers. Craig Rochelle, Hope in the Dark. Rosemary Beach, Florida, summer 2007. "Don't get so far out," I yelled over the wind and the crashing surf. The kids were playing in the waves, laughing and grinning and dunking one another, their heads popping out of the water and going back under like fishermen's bobbers. The day had been almost magical. For a blended family like ours, getting everyone together in the same place at the same time was something of a miracle in itself. Lisa and I sat on the beach, soaking in the sun and the love and the togetherness we so needed. Our older son, Josh, was 22 and about to move from Alabama back to San Antonio to work for his dad. Katie was 18 and head over heels for my scrub tech and Iraq War colleague, Nate, who had come to work for us after the war and had tried for years to resist falling for his employer's daughter, to no avail. Kimber was 15 and lived in a nearby town with her mother, along with 13-year-old Mitch and our youngest daughter, Kaylin, who was 10. Our family was a beautiful, blended mess, but it was our family, and having everyone at the beach together meant the world to us. When God brought Lisa into my life, her kids, Josh and Katie, and my kids, Kimber, Mitch, and Kaylin, instantly became our kids. They even said vows to one another at our wedding. But as the years went by and everyone got older, we knew schedules and jobs and weddings would make days like these even rarer and more special. An hour earlier, Lisa's dad, Dennis, had baptized Nate in the ocean. All of us stood in the waist-deep water and held hands while Dennis led us in prayer and thanked God for the day and the sun and the love swirling in the waves around us. Nate had never been baptized, and he'd asked Dennis, whom the kids have all called Tata since Josh's first attempt as a baby to say Grandpa, whether he would do it. Nate confessed his belief in Jesus. Tata dunked him under the water, and we sang hymns in the Gulf of Mexico. A few miles offshore, a storm was pushing bigger and bigger waves to the beach. It made the body surfing a lot of fun, but at the same time, the rough water brought seaweed and countless jellyfish with it. Josh and Mitch were the first to realize this, and they both came screaming out of the water with jellies in their shorts. We all laughed and cringed simultaneously. And now, as the sun began its brilliant dive into the western sky, and our memory-filled day was drawing to a close, I noticed that Mitch was getting farther and farther from where the other kids still splashed. "Come back in," I called as loudly as I could. Mitch didn't seem to hear. He just waved and dove back under the surf. I stepped out into the water and felt the undercurrent picking up with each departing surge. Mitch wasn't a strong swimmer, and I knew he was too far out to be safe. I waded into the surf to get him, but when Josh heard me call, he noticed his little brother and swam out and brought Mitch in. Josh and Mitch came bounding out of the ocean together, laughing and smiling with their arms around each other. Lisa snapped a couple of pictures of them, which are still in a frame on Josh's desk to this day. I can see that scene in my mind's eye now, a decade later. That's what our family does. We swim out to help one another. From the moment Lisa and I decided to blend our two families into one, it's been all in for all of us. The kids never called one another step-siblings. It's been a beautiful, healing experience to see God turn two hurting groups into one whole tribe. The rest of the family went back up the hill to the house we were renting, and Lisa and I stayed on the beach for a while to enjoy the sunset. We held hands and talked about how faith and family and days like this were so important. As darkness sneaked over the horizon, marking the end of a day I was thankful for, even as I mourned its conclusion, we walked back to the house together. In my mind that night, I replayed the pictures of our five kids in the same frame. I could see their smiles, hear their voices, and feel the love and emotion during Nate's baptism and our special time together. The next morning, we would be returning to Auburn, Alabama, and I knew that within a few days, our vacation would slip into memory as we got back to work. Lisa ran our practice, and the business of solo practice neurosurgery gave both of us more work to do than we'd ever imagined. My last thoughts before I slept that night took me back to the kids in the surf. I could see them playing, see the waves getting rougher and the hidden dangers like jellyfish and riptides lurking around them, see Mitch getting pulled away by the tide and Josh going to help him. Lisa and I talked about how hard it was to not have all of them with us every day and how much we wished it could be different. When they were younger, I could wrap my arms around all of them, pull them out of trouble, keep them safe. Now they were moving and growing and spreading out all over the place, Josh heading to San Antonio, Katie going back home with us, and Kimber, Mitch, and Kaylin leaving for their mom's house an hour from Auburn. It would be a while before we were all together again. How was I supposed to keep them all safe from the riptides of time, growth, and change? While I was growing up, my parents gave me a simple faith. They taught me to trust that God would take care of us and make everything work out all right. We weren't naive to the troubles of the world, but we believed that they were all part of a plan and that we could trust in God's provision in the future because He'd never failed us in the past. I'd applied that same philosophy to raising my own kids, trying to give each of them the peace of mind that comes when faith becomes real in your life. But teaching your kids something is one thing. When you turn off the lights at night and it's just you and your thoughts, how real is it? We were about to spread across the country, go back to our daily lives, be distant from one another. Josh wouldn't be close by to swim out for Mitch anymore. Katie and Kimber would no longer share a room.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.